Hello, and welcome to our presentation today entitled Lynch Syndrome 101, Overview and Current State of the Art. Your presenters today are myself, Joanna Mercado, Catherine Ozelius, and Katherine Skefos. We are all genetic counselors at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. Today, we plan to start with a brief overview of the genetics of Lynch syndrome, then discuss the importance of genetic testing for family members, as well as by ending with, by highlighting new research in the world of Lynch syndrome.
We want to start today with just a quick overview of a few helpful genetics concepts. For some of you, this information you may have heard before, but for others, it might provide some helpful context as we dig deeper into what Lynch syndrome is. So when we think about cancer as a whole, a vast majority, shown here in green, is considered to be sporadic. This means that most cancers happen by chance, or because of a combination of chance, lifestyle factors, and environmental exposures, etc. In about 20% of families, shown here in light purple, we can see a cluster of more cancer than expected, but we're not able to detect a specific genetic factor that is causing that increased incidence of cancer. We call this familial cancer, and we know that families may share environmental or lifestyle factors along with smaller genetic factors that we can't test for yet that may lead to a cluster of cancers in a family. Lastly, the smallest piece of the pie here are what we consider to be hereditary forms of cancer. Hereditary cancers are caused by one specific genetic difference that may be passed down through a family that increases a person's risk of developing cancer. Lynch syndrome is included in that group. Now, before I get specifically into genetic differences that cause Lynch syndrome, let's start with a quick biology refresher. Our body is made up of billions of cells, skin cells, heart cells, eye cells, and within every cell are structures called chromosomes. Chromosomes are made up of very, very long strands of DNA, which is our genetic information. And you can think of our genetic information like the instruction manuals for how our bodies grow and develop. This genetic instruction manual is made up of thousands and thousands of chapters, which we call genes. And amazingly, all of this genetic information is tucked right into every cell of our body. The cell is able to read the instruction manuals of our genes and build proteins that we need to function. Genes provide the instructions to determine things like our eye color and our hair color, but there's also an important set of genes that control our cells' ability to live and grow. And if one of those genes isn't working properly, that can allow cells to live and grow with less control and can cause a person to have an increased chance of developing cancer. A mutation is a harmful change in a gene that causes that gene not to work how it's supposed to work. You can think of it as a misspelling in that instruction manual of our body. Sometimes mutations can occur in genes by chance or due to environmental exposures as a person ages. An example of this is that the sun can cause damage to the genetic information in skin cells that can lead to skin cancer. Other times, though, a person can be born with a mutation in a gene that increases their risk of certain types of cancers. And an example of this is Lynch syndrome. We all have two copies of every gene, one gene we get from our mom and one copy we get from our dad. And we want both copies to be working correctly. People who have a hereditary cancer predisposition, like Lynch syndrome, are born with a mutation in one copy of the gene. So they are at a greater risk to develop cancer and tend to develop cancer at earlier ages than a person who's born with two working copies of the gene. This diagram shows how Lynch syndrome can be passed down through a family. If you have a mutation in one copy of the gene, there's a 50% chance for each of your children to inherit the copy with the mutation and a 50% chance of passing down the working copy of the gene without the mutation. And Lynch syndrome can be passed down from either a mom or a dad.
All right, so now that Catherine is taking you through some of the background information on genetics, I'm going to talk to you more specifically about Lynch syndrome. So as I'm sure most of you are familiar, Lynch syndrome is a hereditary cancer predisposition syndrome, meaning that individuals with Lynch syndrome have increased risks for certain types of cancer over their lifetime. The types of cancer associated with Lynch syndrome are shown in the picture on your screen, which is from Dana-Farber's website. One of the cancers that we think of first when it comes to Lynch syndrome is colorectal cancer, because Lynch syndrome is the most common hereditary cause for colorectal cancer. Other cancers that are associated with Lynch syndrome include stomach, pancreatic, urinary tract, ovarian, uterine, and less commonly, biliary tract cancer, which is your liver, gallbladder, and bile ducts, small bowel and brain cancer, and certain skin findings as well, called sebaceous neoplasms, which can be benign or cancerous. You'll also see prostate cancer listed here. And we do think that some individuals with Lynch syndrome have an increased risk for prostate cancer, but this is fairly new, and we're still figuring out the exact risks for prostate cancer that go along with Lynch syndrome. So I know Catherine talked to you earlier about genes, and there are 5 different genes associated with Lynch syndrome. They are MLH1, MSH2, FCAM, MSH6, and PMS2. An individual with a mutation in any one of these genes has Lynch syndrome. However, while all of these genes are associated with Lynch syndrome and the group of cancers I mentioned before, the exact cancer risks associated with each gene are a little bit different. We do have specific risk numbers for each gene, which I'm not going to go over in detail now, but which are at the end of this presentation for reference if you want to take a look. These numbers are taken from guidelines from NCCN, the National Comprehensive Cancer Network, and we use these numbers to help us think about what the cancer risks are for those with Lynch syndrome, and therefore how to best screen and manage individuals with this syndrome. Like I said, I won't go over risk numbers in detail, but just to give you an idea of the general trends that go along with these 5 genes. So MLH1 is the gene we think of as having some of the highest cancer risks that go along with Lynch syndrome. MSH2 and FCAM have similar risks to each other, which is why they're grouped on your screen, and also similar risks to MLH1, some a bit lower, some risks a bit higher. With MSH6, we start to see some lower risks for cancer than the first 3 genes, and PMS2 we think of as having the lowest risks for cancer out of all of these genes. Some important things to know about these risk numbers I've been talking about. First, we're learning more about Lynch syndrome all the time, so these numbers may change over time as we gather more data. Also, along with these numbers, we use personal and family history to help develop a personalized management plan for each person with Lynch syndrome. Because of this, some screening for Lynch syndrome will look the same between people, some will be a little different depending on your history. The bottom line is that your healthcare team knows you best, so you should always work with them to determine what management plan is best for you. So in terms of how we actually diagnose someone with Lynch syndrome, typically we're doing what we call germline testing, which is genetic testing that's designed to look for genetic changes or mutations someone was born with, also known as germline mutations. However, there are a few different ways that individuals get to the point of having a germline test. Some people have a suspicious pattern of cancer in their family that looks like it fits with Lynch syndrome. And when I say a suspicious pattern of cancer, what that would look like is multiple cancers in the family that we know are associated with Lynch syndrome, especially if they were diagnosed at younger ages, like under the age of 50. Also, some people have germline testing because there is already a known diagnosis of Lynch syndrome in the family, and they know that they are also at risk to have Lynch syndrome because of that. Other people come to genetics for germline testing because they have cancer, and the results of their tumor testing or cancer testing on their cancer cells are suspicious for Lynch syndrome. Colon and endometrial tumors are often screened for Lynch syndrome with this tumor testing, and there are some specific findings when this is done that tell doctors that maybe that person has Lynch syndrome. Tumor testing itself does not give someone a diagnosis of Lynch syndrome, just finds people who might be more likely to have it. These individuals that are more likely are usually referred to genetics and then undergo germline testing to see if they do have Lynch syndrome. Just like with the specific risk numbers on the last slide, I'm not going to go over what germline and somatic testing or tumor testing looks like in detail. But if you are interested, you can always ask us questions about it during our question and answer time, or you can ask your healthcare team. So now that we've talked about how an individual gets diagnosed with Lynch syndrome, let's talk about how we think about testing family members when someone in a family is positive for a mutation in a Lynch syndrome gene. In front of you is a family tree, or what we call a pedigree. Some of you may be very familiar with this. Circles represent females, squares represent males, and each individual with a colored portion of their shape has had some type of cancer. CO stands for colon cancer, endo for endometrial or uterine cancer, and OV for ovarian cancer. The person with the arrow pointing to them is the person coming to see us in clinic, also known as the proband. This, just so you know, is not a real family. It's just one that I made up as an example for you. So usually we like to test someone in a family first who has had a cancer diagnosis, because they're the one we're most likely to find something in, if we're going to find anything. But sometimes that isn't possible or reasonable. So let's say in this family, this 38-year-old woman comes to see us in clinic because of this suspicious family history. We test her first, and she is found to be positive for a mutation in a Lynch syndrome gene, meaning she has Lynch syndrome. Just as a note, I'm not talking about a specific gene in this example. So LS positive in this example means positive for Lynch syndrome on testing, and LS minus or negative means negative for Lynch syndrome. So from here, we know first degree relatives have a 50% chance to have the same mutation that was found in this woman, meaning her siblings, children, and we also assume that the mutation was inherited from one of her parents. For children, we usually don't do testing until they're at least 18, so that they get to have the same choice as an adult about whether or not they want to know if they have Lynch syndrome. For adults, it's really a personal choice on if and when to get testing, and there are many different reasons someone may or may not have testing done. I'm not going to talk about these reasons in detail today, but there is a slide for reference at the end of this talk that lays out some reasons people choose to do or decline to have genetic testing. For folks who want testing, timing is, again, personal. Some people get tested at age 18 as soon as they can. Some get tested closer to when screening or management changes would start, and others wait until they're emotionally ready to know these results. So they may wait quite a while to have testing. Still others have testing for the purposes of family planning to know if there's a risk to their current or future children to have Lynch syndrome. Some providers or institutions may also recommend that partners of individuals with Lynch syndrome get genetic testing done, because there is a rare condition that can occur if both parents of a child have a mutation in the same Lynch syndrome gene and pass both of those mutations on to a child. So the child has two Lynch syndrome gene mutations, one in each of their two copies of that gene instead of just one mutation. This condition is called constitutional mismatch repair deficiency, or CMMRD, and we can see cancers much earlier, like in childhood, as well as other features that we don't see with Lynch syndrome. Like I mentioned, this condition is very rare, so whether or not partner testing is recommended will probably depend on where you're seen, and it may not always be discussed. So let's come back to this example in front of us. Let's say this individual's siblings all decide to get tested, and one brother is positive with the rest being negative. In this example, it's a pretty even split, two positive, three negative, but it isn't always that way. For example, sometimes we see all siblings being positive or all being negative. It's not necessarily gonna be a 50-50 split in each family. For the people that are negative, we don't think there's a risk for that Lynch syndrome mutation to be passed on to their kids, because you can't pass on what you don't have. For the brother who is positive, eventually we wanna think about testing his kids as well as our proband's daughter. So we also want to figure out which side of the family this mutation is coming from. Dad's side certainly looks more suspicious given the colon, endometrial, and ovarian cancers, but mom's side does have that one colon cancer, and we never want to assume, even if one side does look more likely, because sometimes one side looks more likely and we end up finding out it's coming from the other side. So let's say both parents get tested and we find that mom is negative and dad is positive, not surprisingly. From here, we want to test the family members closest to dad first, so his brothers and sisters. When we test family members, it's not uncommon for someone not to want testing. So in this example, let's say dad's 63-year-old brother refuses testing, but the two aunts and uncles that are remaining have testing done with the following results. Not surprisingly, the aunt with endometrial cancer is found to be positive. However, you can see that the aunt who had colorectal cancer, who we might expect to be positive because it would fit with Lynch syndrome, is actually negative. So it's important to keep in mind that just because Lynch syndrome is in a family doesn't mean that all of the cancers in the family are caused by Lynch syndrome. Also, just because someone has never had cancer doesn't mean they don't have Lynch syndrome. So as you can see, the 70-year-old uncle here who has never had cancer did test positive. So from here, we would think about testing cousins. And I'm not going to go into detail about this because I think you get the point about testing. But I'll just quickly talk about one cousin, the daughter of the 63-year-old uncle who didn't want testing. When we have someone who doesn't want testing in a situation like this but has kids that do want testing, we often just test their kids. So here, let's say we test his daughter. She comes back negative. It doesn't tell us anything about her father's results, but she's able to have that information for herself. The last thing I'll mention is that there is a page on the National Society of Genetic Counselors website that allows people to look up genetic counselors in their area. And this can be really helpful when family members are looking for genetic professionals that can help them to get genetic testing, especially when they don't live in the same area as another family member who was tested. And the URL for that website, if you need it, is down at the bottom of the slide as a resource for you.
Now moving on to a different topic regarding Lynch syndrome. As we make improvements in the field of cancer genetics and medicine, our focus has become more about tailoring the care for our patients and making it more personalized. The following information being presented is an overview of most recent improvements being made to provide more personalized care and management for our Lynch syndrome patients. To help improve the quality of care for our patients, a tool called Ask to Me was created. The discussion of lifetime risks can be overwhelming. Both clinicians and genetic counselors needed a tool to help interpret results, advise on management strategy, and to understand risks of various cancers across different age groups, or help provide information to patients about more immediate future risks versus lifetime risk. The Bayes-Mendel Lab at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and the Hughes Lab at Mass General Hospital jointly developed Ask to Me, which have identified reliable studies that have converted the results of these studies into clinically relevant cancer risk estimates for a number of genes, including the genes associated with Lynch syndrome. By allowing clinicians to enter patient information and receive patient-specific cancer risks, or again, more immediate future risks, this tool aims to have an impact on the quality of precision cancer prevention and management. Here, the slide provides information on the colorectal cancer risk for a 35-year-old female MSH2 carrier. As you can see, it provides estimates risk within 5 to 10-year intervals up to age 85, which is the projected lifetime risk estimates. Again, this helps break down the cancer risk by age group, which can help the clinician and patient together make decisions on medical management. Another update in the world of Lynch syndrome was a recent publication about the use of daily aspirin for Lynch syndrome carriers. As we are aware, frequent colonoscopies are beneficial for individuals with Lynch syndrome, but there are some limitations. Therefore, new approaches in management, such as chemo prevention, are appealing in Lynch syndrome, which leads us to the CAP2 study. Between January 1999 and 2005, this study recruited patients based on age, along with either having a genetic or clinical diagnosis of Lynch syndrome. Participants were given either 600 milligrams of aspirin daily or placebo. These cancer outcomes were monitored for at least 10 years, up to 20 years. This graph here highlights the outcome of the study. The blue line represents those that were given placebo, while the red represents those that were given the 600 milligram aspirin daily. And the y-axis on the bottom of each graph represents up to 20 years. The top graphs, both A and B, is data on the incidence of colorectal cancer, while the bottom graphs C and D provide incidence of all Lynch syndrome cancers. As you can see, overall, the study confirms that 600 milligrams daily for at least 2 years reduces the risk for a future cancer. However, the study did also discuss that for endometrial cancers, which is the most common Lynch syndrome cancer after colorectal cancer. The data was suggestive, but not conclusive of protection effect of aspirin. They also investigated whether aspirin treatment affected the staging in which these cancers were diagnosed, and there was no evidence of any stage differences. Additionally, the study discussed that Lynch syndrome carriers who may obtain little benefit from aspirin might include those with lower risk for colorectal cancer, such as our PMS2 carriers. Overall, the study provides intriguing information showing that 600 milligrams per day reduces the risk for colorectal cancer in patients with Lynch syndrome. Yet the decision to use aspirin should be made on an individualized basis, including a discussion with your physician about dose, benefits, and adverse events. While the CAP2 study certainly provides compelling information, the CAP3 trial is looking to investigate whether lower dose aspirin dosage, such as 100 milligrams per day and 300 milligrams per day, are inferior to 600 milligrams per day in reducing the Lynch syndrome-associated cancer, colorectal cancer incidence. Additionally, they're also looking to study events associated with daily aspirin use. Thank you, and we look forward to answering your questions in the live chat in September. Thank you so much.